Frisco has a rich history beginning just before the turn of the century. The St. Louis San Francisco Railroad Company completed a track from Denison to Carrollton.
The railroad had everything to do with Frisco.
The company dug a lake essential for steam engines to get water and built a four-room depot. In 1902, the Blackland Town Site Company, a subsidiary of the railroad, decided conditions were ripe to set up a town.
They offered free transportation up and down the railroad for people who bought lots, and they advertised as far north as Chicago, St. Louis, and all those areas. So people came from far and near. I understand that they furnished free whiskey to get the people all oiled up so they'd bid high on the lots.
The new settlers wanted to name the town Emerson after the original owner of the land, Francis Emerson, but that name hit a snag.
When they applied for a post office under the name Emerson, they were told that that would not work because there is a town in Lamar County, around close to Paris, called Emerson.
The Postal Service feared the similar names would create confusion, so the people decided Frisco City was a good name, but the postmaster shortened it to Frisco after the railroad.
People moved from Lebanon and they moved from Little Elm. People and businesses and even homes, as you know, their homes were rolled over here on logs from Lebanon.
One of those homes still sits on the corner of Main and Fifth Streets and now houses a restaurant. In 1908, the residents voted to incorporate the city and elected the first city council and mayor, Dr. I.S. Rogers. He also built the first new house in Frisco. Frisco's first census in 1910 showed a population of 332 people. That number more than doubled by the 1920 census.
I thought it was heaven because I'd always lived in the country.
Ruth Bogart moved to Frisco in 1918 when she was 12 years old.
Downtown Frisco, they had a couple of grocery stores. They had a dry goods store, and the funeral home had their coffins and what have you in back of a hardware store. The day that the armistice was signed in 1918, I was here, and all day long, people went up and down Main Street in the cars, just driving up and down the street, and yelling and hollering.
Bogart remembers something else about the day World War I ended, a neighbor who wanted to celebrate.
She gathered up a bunch of the kids on the street and took us downtown to where we could see some of the activity. And the icing on the cake was, when we started home, she bought us all a nickel Hershey bar. And that was the first time I had ever had a bar of candy that I didn't have to share.
Bogart and other early Frisco students went to school in a three-story brick building built in 1912 for a little more than $11,000.
When I got to Frisco, we just had one grade in a room. We did our own entertainment. As I say, we would have parties, we would have picnics, we would have possum hunts.
Cletus Bristol also has fond memories of growing up in Frisco.
Well, kids, we used to go down to the lake and go swimming a lot. Well, you go in the nude because there's all Frisco Lake down there where the trains got water and so on. And we played a lot of baseball.
Even in Frisco in its very early days, a child didn't dare go do something because it'd make its way back to his parents before he'd get home.
For many years, Kurt Singer Drugstore was the gathering place for young and old alike.
And they had a piano at the drugstore. And especially on Sunday afternoon, we would meet down there and Claude could really knock the bottom out of a piano.
The drugstore was also home to the town's first radio and served as a bus stop between Sherman and Dallas. It was one of the only buildings spared when fire raced through downtown in 1922, forever changing Frisco.
The town was so small that when the fire alarm went off, everybody in town could hear it. So everybody in town went to the fire.
I think it started in Charlie Triffitt's restaurant when a pan of grease caught on fire. And it was late in the afternoon. And golly, you could see that fire for miles and miles around.
That whole block from City Hall East on the south side was gutted by fire. The only thing remaining in one of the pictures is the arch from the old picture show. It was a brick arch. It's now the arch on the Masonic Hall. On the north side of the street, the fire spread over there. Everything was wooden, all the buildings, livery stables, blacksmith shops, everything was wooden. Even the sidewalks were wooden. I can imagine people, as they saw the flames, they said, there goes Frisco. There'll never be another Frisco. And they were wrong. The town came back as a brick and mortar. And it didn't take very long for them to rebuild. About a year, everything was back much better than it was before.
The fire compelled city leaders to establish a new water system and improve firefighting equipment. Dr. W.L. Say also passed the hat around town and raised $90 to get a new warning siren.
We owe a lot to those people that brought Frisco up from the ashes.
Even the Great Depression could not keep Frisco down, though both banks had already failed before the stock market crashed. Frisco's dependence on farming helped ease the hardships of the troubled financial times.
They grew gardens, they grew, they had cows, they had pigs and chickens. And even Frisco's early days, they had all those things in town here.
And our livelihood was the farmers, everybody, and we depended on them.
Harold Backus came to Frisco as director of the railroad in the 40s. Trains carried local farmers' crops all over the country.
So it was nothing unusual to ship out 300 cars of grain a year, and each one of these cars could hold upward of 200,000 pounds. So that's a lot of grain.
Main Street was also a stop for South Texas cattle headed north on the train.
They would unload the cattle here in Frisco in the pens, give them feed and water, and let them stay 8 or 10 hours, then load them back up for a trip to Kansas City where they'd sell them.
The passenger trains provided entertainment for the locals.
Everybody would meet the train, passenger train, to see who would come and leave.
In the 40s, some of those passengers were Frisco's own young men headed to war. More than 250 Frisco men served in World War II. Those who didn't make it home are remembered at the war memorial erected by the Frisco Garden Club.
We had rationing, gas stamps, food stamps. All of those things were rationed during the war, but a lot of people didn't have enough sugar. Sugar was very difficult to get.
Even teachers like Wilma Fisher, who taught business classes at the new Frisco High School built in 1939, sacrificed supplies during the war.
When the war began, they asked for schools to donate the typewriters, and they donated the best ones. naturally. And so we were left with the ones that didn't work very well.
In the early years, downtown Frisco was booming every Saturday night.
Saturday was when all the farmers came to town, and it was just a big carnival.
They'd come to town to visit mostly, and they'd come in there and buy groceries, and we didn't want to put them in a wagon or a buggy, and they'd leave them there in the store, so we'd have to stay open until the store closed, until the picture show closed, so they could pick up their groceries. But every Saturday night when that store had closed, I'd go down there about 11 o'clock, and I'd be the last one in, but that barbershop would stay open as long as there's anyone there.
And the parents would go and just visit, and then all the kids went to the movie.
I can remember walking from my house on North County down to the movie theater, which was in the first block of the old Main Street, and thinking it was such a long way. But I knew everybody that lived along the way.
The 50s brought another Saturday night pastime to Frisco.
Well, the TVs, that was really something, and of course no one in their homes had TVs. But John Carter had an appliance store in Frisco, and he had the first TVs. And people would go down there on Saturday night and watch boxing.
Saturday night was the big night, and that's when the drunks came to town too.
That's why the city council built this calaboose, a two-room concrete building with no lights or water. Then the city marshal didn't have to leave town to take drunks to jail in McKinney.
I helped a marshal, city marshal, and we locked up a drunk in the calaboose on Friday night. I came to work Monday morning, somebody hollering, "Help, help." And I thought about it then. We had left this guy in there from Friday night till Monday morning, no water, no food, no nothing. And I went over and talked to him. And I asked him, I said, "Do you come back Frisco drinking again?" He said, "No, I'll never be back to Frisco again." As far as I know, he never came back.
Fortunately, most people who came to Frisco had a much better experience. Sammy Lane Bond's dad was mayor in the 40s.
If anyone came through town and needed a place to spend the night, they spent the night at our house.
The thing that touched me most was the friendliness of the people and the acceptance they gave me. I wasn't expecting that.
All the time that I was growing up, we had 736 people in Frisco, and everybody knew everybody. And we all knew everybody's business.
That was especially true of the town's telephone operator.
We had what we call Central. That was the operator. And you had the telephone where you rang it. And the operator would say, "Number, please." And you would give us 60 or 71. It was usually just two numbers. She might say, "Well, Miss So-and-so has gone shopping today and she's not at home."
Of course, we always accused Miss Riddle of knowing all the secrets of the community because she could listen in on the calls.
They told me when I came here, "Don't talk about anybody. You'll be talking about someone's kinfolks."
Tracy King and his family chose to call Frisco home and bought the bank in 1950.
It was just a nice little country town. It had some nice homes.
Dr. W.L. Say was Frisco's only doctor for many years. His office was in the back of Kurt Singer Drug.
When I would have a loose tooth, I wouldn't let my parents pull my tooth. I'd go down to Dr. Say and sit in his chair, and he'd pull my tooth. And I'd go home, and he never charged, he never charged for anything like that.
After Dr. Say died, the community built a medical clinic to try to attract a doctor.
July the 1st of 1954, that's the first full day I worked in Frisco.
Dr. Irwin Pink took the bait and came to Frisco fresh out of medical school.
So when you finished working the office, you had a list of house calls, then maybe two, three, four, five, or six of them. And you'd work all day, you didn't ever worry a whole lot whether you're getting paid or not, because you knew those that would pay you could, and those that couldn't, wouldn't. And the farmers would generally pay you once a year when the crops came in. If the crops didn't come in, they'd pay you the next year.
Dr. Pink also served as Frisco High's team physician for 43 years.
That's where I got the name Painless. The kids got to call me Painless Pink because you just lay them down on the bench or put them on a car hood or something and deaden those things and the best you could and clean them up and stitch them up and put them back in the ballgame.
During football season, homecoming has always been a big deal. Crowds gather on Main Street to watch elaborate floats made by students, teachers, and parents. But in the 50s, the event provided only a temporary diversion for Frisco kids.
And there wasn't a darn thing for kids to do here. I mean, nothing. Play football during the school year.
Halloween was always a fun time. And the high school guys, they loved to go get Mr. Bell's outhouse. And they would bring it down to Main Street.
Kids in Frisco needed something to occupy their time. After Alan Anderson refused to let some boys swim in his lake because it was dangerous, he suggested the idea of building a swimming pool and youth center.
Frisco really backed both of those things because there had not been anything really except ingenuity of the youth for what to do for entertainment.
The citizens of Frisco pitched in and raised almost $45,000.
Every dime of that was done through kids raising money or through donations. And we operated that thing for a good many years and gave it to the city of Frisco, debt-free.
A chunk of money came from Dallas oil man Doug Forbes after he called Dr. Pink looking for help.
But I've got a right-hand man down here, so he said, and he's a black guy, I said, and he's sick. I said, do you see black people? And I said, I see anybody. I said, make any difference to me what color.
Later that day, Forbes' wife called with a special thank you.
Doug was so impressed with you getting out and seeing our employee on Sunday morning that we want to send your youth center $5,000. I like to fell flat on my face.
In 1956, the pool opened, and 4 years later, Speaker of the House Sam Rayburn dedicated the community-built youth center in front of a crowd of 3,000 people.
I wore high heels, you know, and we dressed up and went to the youth center for the opening of the dedication of the youth center.
In 1964, the opening of the city's first elementary school only marked another big day in Frisco.
It was a grand affair when they dedicated this school. It was in the fall and a lot of people came.
Two sisters donated the 11-acre site and named the school after their father, Z.T. Acker.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock.
A favorite hangout around this time was the Royal Drive-In.
It was really the meeting place for all the teenagers and all the adults too for many, many years.
If you want to get out and hear everything in town and what might be going on or what might not be going on, go to the Royal. You can get it all.
There was no shortage of excitement around Frisco to talk about. A tornado swept through the town in 1962, doing $200,000 in damage. A bank robbery hostage situation made headlines in 1974.
So this man come in, I won't call him a gentleman because he robbed me. He pulled out this 45 and his hand was shaking, that gun was shaking. I went back there and got $20,000 worth of money. And just like he told me to do. Well, we got in my car and I drove. He told me to drive. And so we took off and one of the tellers, Ellie Minner, met me on the way out on 720 and said she thought it's odd that I didn't wave at her.
The robber let King go just outside of town. The bad guy was later caught after he robbed the Prosper Bank. The 1960 census showed Frisco reaching quadruple digits for the first time, 1,184 people. As the population grew, so did the need for city services.
One policeman who didn't have a car, Mr. Lane, and we used to call him White Earp because he would dress the part. He had a Levi's and a Western shirt, and he wore six shooters beneath each hip. And I don't know whether he could shoot or not, but he would walk up down Main Street.
The merchants pitched in to pay his salary. Crews repaired city streets every other year.
And Mr. Montgomery would supervise it. And he wouldn't take any money. We'd Jenny buy him a Stetson hat at the Martin Dry Goods store.
And in 1978, the Ewings called a Frisco landmark home. The Newsome Ranch already had an infamous history even before the TV show Dallas came calling.
That house that they built out there, big two-story fine mansion, was built partly from black market lumber, because lumber was, during the war, was kept away from a civilian building.
But this was really something, because this was a home that we had not seen here before. You know, it was so beautiful and big.
A former NFL player owned the ranch by the time JR and family moved in, but after a year, he had had enough of Hollywood.
They filmed the opening scenes there, and they filmed a lot of the things in and around it, but it was disruptive to him and his ranching situation. So he told them at the end of that year that they'd have to find another place. That's when they moved to South Fork.
Years later, a fire spark during remodeling destroyed the mansion.
Then we thought they would build it back, you know, just real soon, and they built that frame that's there now and never did finish it, and they sold it to Grantland.
By this time, the railroad no longer fueled Frisco's economy, but railroad president Lewis W. Menk still played a key role in getting the city's industrial economy off the ground. Dr. Pink and two other members of the industrial board flew to Springfield, Missouri to make their pitch for a land donation.
And Mr. Mink came and met with us one Sunday morning, 10 o'clock in the morning, and sat there and listened to our pitch and looked at our numbers, and finally leaned back in his chair and he says, "I want to tell you guys something." He says, "Anybody that's crazy enough to come up here and roll out the CEO of a major corporation on Sunday morning and ask for a gift of 100 acres land," he said, "Hallibus will give it to you." And that's how we got the 100 acres where GNB is today, or Exide.
We were looking to be another Plano. We knew it was coming, and we thought it was going to come in about 10 years, which is about, we thought we were about 10 years behind Plano.
With that growth projection in mind in 1966, city leaders took action.
We drilled new water wells, we built new water storage tanks, the railroad gave us land on Stewart Creek, and we built a new sewer plant. We extended a water main to McKinney for supplemental water from Lake Levan. And we had all infrastructures in place. And to protect our interest, in one night, we annexed 100 square miles of land.
The move seemed premature at the time, but that foresight gave the city plenty of room to grow and kept neighboring cities from gobbling up prized property.
We knew that our time would come. Everybody misjudged when it would come.
'70s was kind of it was a growing period too. I mean, there were things going on, houses being built. There wasn't a lot of resistance to anything, and people were really wanting growth at the time.
The recession of the early 80s took a toll on Frisco's fledging development.
When the real estate bust and the savings and loan situation came along, it really put a damper on everything as far as growth around here is concerned. In 1987, we hired our first city manager, George Purefoy. We had, just before that, we had realized that we had reached the 5,000 mark on population.
I think there was 45 employees when I came. They had just held their home rule election in May of 87.
That city charter gave Frisco more freedom to govern itself.
Well, our immediate goal was to try to go out and find a secure water supply for the city. Without an adequate water supply, I mean, you can have all the land in the world, but you don't have water for people. I mean, you can't sustain any growth.
That goal was accomplished when Frisco joined the North Texas Municipal Water District that supplies water to the city. Kathy C.I. moved to Frisco in 1985.
Back in the 80s, Frisco knew it was going to grow, but then the economy took a downturn. And so they were poised on the edge of their seat waiting for that growth in 1990.
Okay.
In the early 90s, Frisco voters passed a half-cent sales tax, which supports the Community Development Corporation and the Economic Development Corporation.
All these bond sales and elections for taxes were very widely and heavily supported by the people. The citizens were great. They really stayed with us.
In 1992, the City Council finalized Frisco's first master plan.
That first master plan laid out the road systems, sewer, water, addressed those very basic needs.
Basic needs for a growing city include dependable public safety agencies. Frisco has that in award-winning fire and police departments.
These guys work all the time, and I think if you take the fire service itself, it is so much more professional now than what it was when we were doing it.
Frisco's fire department has achieved the rare distinction of the highest insurance rating for the best level of fire protection. The police department has been recognized for outstanding participation in National Night Out for 8 years in a row.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Touch a life today and make a difference.
Community participation is critical to Frisco's success in education.
I expected about what I found, and that was a group of parents and kids that they really cared about each other and the community and were winners.
Superintendent of Frisco Schools, Dr. Rick Reedy, has watched Frisco evolve since he arrived in 1976.
Over the last 25 years, as those farms have turned into communities within communities, the Starwoods, the Trails of West Frisco, the Kings Ridge development, which was one of the first ones to start hitting in about the mid-80s, the plantation resorts, and our challenge has been to bring all of those into this nuclear family, and I think we've succeeded at that.
The population explosion earned Frisco ISD the title of the fastest growing school district in Texas.
And then in the early 90s, all the factors came together and we first started growing at 12% a year, and then 18, and then 24, and then the last two or three years, 30.
Once again, the community rallied to help, passing bond elections to fuel construction.
The standard has always been is what's good for the city is good for the school district and vice versa. And that's allowed us to form these kind of alliances that continue to help us thrive today.
Five new schools opened in 2002, and a second high school is scheduled to open in 2003. Projections show the student population will almost double to more than 22,000 students by 2005.
We have established a distinct identity as a school district that relates to one community, and that's old downtown Frisco, that is that's at the heart and core and center of everything that we do. The changes have been dramatic. The changes have been dramatic in the sense that the houses are bigger, they're more expensive, and there's zillions of them. But I think the core values have stayed the same.
Go ahead and open it up and just create a text file in there.
For higher education, Frisco is home to the Preston Ridge campus of the Collin County Community College. Opened in 1995, the school offers high-tech and computer courses, as well as core and continuing education classes. Frisco's latest master plan, drafted by the council in 2000, provides the blueprint for growth for the next 20 years. The Millennium Plan was named best in the state.
We looked more at quality of life issues this time, realizing how large we were going to be. And so our goal was, how do you keep that great sense of community when you're a large city?
As new people move in here, you'll find that they're moving in from all over the country, from all over the United States.
As the population grows, so does Frisco's diversity in culture and religion. Dozens of different faiths worship here. Some congregations have been here as long as the city. Others are fairly new to Frisco's fold.
And they see a welcome mat out for them when they move here. And I think they see the opportunity to get involved and to be part of the city.
I think what works in Frisco is the partnerships. That even though you may disagree with each other on some issues, that the vision still keeps out there in front and people pull together to accomplish that vision. I think that makes us unique.
Nowhere was that determined spirit more evident than the fight to win a shopping mall.
We saw the mall slip away from us several times. We thought it had gone south.
After 12 years of negotiating and battling with neighboring Plano, Frisco landed Stonebriar Center. And with more than 160 stores, it's the largest mall in North Texas.
They finally came through for us, and that was probably the biggest thing that happened to Frisco as far as an economic engine is concerned.
The main reason why we went after the mall so hard was that we felt like the sales tax that would generate the city in the coming decades would really make the difference between Frisco being able, its citizens being able to have the amenities that they wanted.
But the mall was only the catalyst for growth in the Preston 121 corridor.
But all the little stores, you know, the shopping and the restaurants, it's right here. So that's the uniqueness of it. You know, we got everything at our palm of our hand.
Other than retail, office space is also booming in Frisco. An example, the 162-acre Hall Office Park offers 4 million square feet of office space. The complex also boasts another Frisco first.
We have the largest Texas outdoor sculpture collection in the United States.
Frisco's Economic Development Corporation uses all of these positives and other incentives to lure businesses here. Soon, Frisco will have two hospitals within its borders, and construction is underway to turn the Jetport into an industrial park for technology companies. A park of a very different kind is under construction in West Frisco.
It's going to be a very special place that we'll all be proud to gather at.
In September 2001, we were able to complete the deal with Southwest Sports to build the minor league team facilities, ballpark, and the Star Center, which will be the practice facility for the All-Stars.
The Frisco Rough Riders will throw out the first pitch in the new park in 2003. Also creating momentum is Frisco Square. Architects designed this 145-acre town center to be an extension of the current downtown. Plans call for more than 1.9 million square feet of office and retail space, as well as 400 town homes. Voters approved bonds for a new city hall, library, and senior center, all to be housed in Frisco Square. In 2001, Frisco became the first city in the U.S. to require that all new homes meet federal energy efficiency standards. The council has also adopted other measures to protect the environment.
We just knew it was the right thing to do to take care of the environment, preserve our creekways, preserve our trees.
Frisco is also intent on preserving its rich past.
So far, we've had the councils that have been receptive to building a city that is really, I'm going to say, a landmark rather than trying to push throw up buildings and create business. And I think we've got it on the right track.
The Frisco Heritage Association hopes to use this original caboose from the Frisco Railroad as cornerstones for a historical park.
I think it's very good that we're honoring the past.
And I used to say then that Frisco was capital of the world. And I think I still think that.
Hopefully when you drive into Frisco in the future, you'll be able to know that you're in a different city just because it looks different, it feels different. And I think we're putting that character into Frisco because of these projects and because of the people that live here.
This is where I belong, and this is part of me.
You can be who you are and be the best of who you are right here in Frisco, Texas.
This town is really going to blossom in the next 20 years, I think. We've only scraped the tip of the iceberg.
There's a really a can-do spirit. It's just not talked about. I don't think there's anything that Frisco people don't think that they all work together, they can't accomplish.